My name is Steve Demme, and I'll be your instructor. And who doesn't know who I am? Good. No. Really? All right. Here's my background for math, which is this is a math workshop. And I'm not going to be selling you anything. I did write Matthew C curriculum, and that's the last I'm going to mention it. All right? I'm just going to be teaching you everything I know about fractions in 1 hour. So you will learn everything there is to know about fractions in an hour. So the plan is that we're going to start, not going to assume anything, and we're going to go right up through. Now, my background was I was a high school math teacher back in the 80s, and then I taught junior high math, and then I taught upper elementary, and I kind of worked backwards. But I've done a lot of thinking about math. Can you hear me okay? Is the acoustics fine? And the fractions, though, I used to teach this mostly in high school to students that were not going to graduate. There were certain group of kids that would have, I mean, fractions, decimals, and percents were like the end of what they called like the GED requirements. And then you had the pre-algebra and the algebras and the kids that would be going to college. So I had kids that had shop for half a day, and then they had math and English about the other half of the day. And that was it. See if they could get a diploma. They actually got a certificate of attendance. It's kind of sad, and so you wouldn't know when they walked through the line. But I knew, and they knew. But one of the hardest things for me to teach them was fractions. And I used to spend months teaching what I'm going to teach you in an hour. And a lot of it has to do with two things. Number one, I now understand fractions thoroughly. And number two, I have a tool that has been the slickest thing for me to help people to understand it. Because when you see it, what I'm hoping is you'll understand it. I'm hoping that the visual will be a key into your understanding of the topic, okay? But if you had just walked over to a table and picked up this little cloth kit, you might not know what to do with it. And that's where the understanding comes in on my part, you know, because it does help to know what to do with the tool. So, how many of you, when you were in school, really enjoyed fractions? All right, about a fourth of you. We'll use our fractions right away. About one-fourth of the audience liked fractions. And the other ones are, that's why I'm here, why are you asking that question? So, let's pray for those that didn't raise their hand so that we will understand. The closer you can come to the front, I just have this little bitty illustrator thing, the more you're going to be able to see. If you can see that from way back there, you're good. Good morning. This is one of my prized pupils. She's one of those front row Christians. You belong to her. Oh, okay. Sorry. Well, let's pray anyway. Maybe something will happen. Okay. Father, thank you that you said to ask in all things, to pray in all things. And so we're praying for help in understanding fractions. Help me to present it, help the audience to ask the right questions if I don't present it properly, and help it so that when this hour is over, we really learn this subject and have a much more confident grasp of it. In Jesus' name, amen. Just curious, because yesterday for the first time, I signed a mother's book. Normally I sign books and stuff for kids, you know, but a mother was the one that was more motivated than anybody in their family to understand math. And so I thought, how many of you are here for your own personal knowledge as opposed to just being able to teach your kids? Well, let's just do the first one first. Just your own personal knowledge, all right? And then for the both. That's probably going to get the rest of you. So, but still, it was interesting. And the talk I'm doing next over in the main auditorium is called Disciples. And one of the things that we've talked about in our own family is, what is a disciple? And one of our definitions is, and there's several aspects or facets, but one of them is a lifelong learner, someone that doesn't stop learning when they get a piece of paper. And it's interesting, but some of the people that I would choose to have on my trivia pursuit team, if I was in somebody's home and we're dividing up, are the people that didn't go to college. Because some of, and I can think of people there, jump right out of my sister-in-law, for example, never went to college, didn't do well in high school because she was taking drugs, I think. She had a pretty checkered past, and then she was converted, and she is one of the most up-to-date, current events. She's always reading and watching this news, and she really is a brilliant in some ways. And then the people I went to college with, somehow they feel like when they got that piece of paper, they knew everything, and they just kind of turned off their learning drive or something. So I really want to foster that. So if you're here just to learn, then I'm on your team. Now, when you do fractions, the first thing we're going to talk about, there are three components to fractions, not two. Normally we think of numerator and denominator, but there's actually three. And I just did one a minute ago. I said 1/4 of the audience was, remember, really liked fractions. So it's 1/4 of the audience, because you're never probably going to be asked, what's 1/4? You're going to be asked 1/4 of what? Okay? So of what is what I want to talk about. And that's the third component. Fractions are fractions of something. They're not just, no one's going to ever call you and say, what's 1/2 plus 1/3? That never happens. But they might say, well, 1/2 of the audience, you know, had sneakers, and another third, and so what's the total amount of the audience? Because it's always a half of something, all right? So I'm going to illustrate that by using these little green blocks, and this is the only time I'm going to do this. How many blocks do I have up here right now?
Six.
So let's take 2/3 of 6. And you see the three components. Now, the reason that you learn math is to do word problems. So whenever possible, I'm not going to use the multiplication sign, but that's a multiplication problem, okay? But most of the time, you're going to say 1/4 of the audience, or 2/3 of the attendees at the conference, or I really want to do this sometime. I want to find out what fraction of homeschoolers have vans. Okay? Because I was out in St. Louis a few weeks ago. I forget what it was a blur. I'm getting older, you know. And I noticed there was a plethora of vans. And I really wanted to stop. If I had time before the convention, I was going to count all the vehicles and find out how many were vans. Because I think it really is a high percentage. Anyway, we're going to start with 6. So I've got 6. This line here is very important to understand. That line means divided by. As I understand it, historically, if you wanted to write 12 divided by 4 in olden times, you would write it like this. And then later, there was this push, I think, to put things on one line. I think it was because of the typewriter. So they put the 12 out here, and a little dot to show that's where the 12 used to be. Then you put the 4 out here, and a little dot to show that's where the 4 used to be. And so then we have this symbol. But it emanated from this, which means what?
Divided by.
And you're going to divide it by the bottom number. And the divide by the denominator. The D's go together, right? So you're going to divide by the denominator. If you want a little history of that, denominator means the name in Latin. In this case, it would be the thirds. So we're going to take 6, and we're going to look at this symbol, and it reminds us to divide by 3, right? Good morning. Where's your friend? She slept in? Oh, okay. Okay, her son's birthday is today. And so the other friend is feeling very guilty this morning. So anyway, so 6 divided by 3 is what? Well, let's pretend we don't know. So let's just take, and we want to divide 6 up into 3 equal parts. So we put 3 equal parts. Okay? Oh, that's not equal. It worked. You caught it. Okay, so that was on purpose. So we've got 6, we divide into 3 equal parts, and how many of those parts do we want? The 2. Now the top number I call the numberator. Numberator. Because the numberator tells me how many. Numberator. And so I want 2 of those parts, and so now I have what? 4. You see that? So you see my 3 steps. What I start with, I divide it up into that many equal parts, and take those. After I use that numerator word for a while, I cross out the B, and what do I have? Numerator, okay? But I want people to understand that this is the how many part. Now, if I can just go back, just a little fuzz here, and tie this in with the decimal system. In the decimal system, if this is 1, and this is 10, and this is 100, okay? We have something called place value. And in the decimal system, let me just put a few more up here to make it more interesting. What's this guy called? 100. What's this one? A 10. What's this? You could call them ones. Most people call them ones. I call them units because I want one to be telling me how many and unit to be telling me what kind. So how many hundreds do I have? One. How many tens do I have? How many units do I have? Two. So these things here, these digits tell me how many, but hundreds, tens, units, thousands, millions, trillions tell me what value or what kind. Does that make sense? And it's really important in the decimal system because you only have 0 through 9, and where those numbers are determines how large or how small they are, right? Okay. Now, let's take that to fractions. I could write this as 2 times 1/3, couldn't I? This is about as heady as I'm going to get in this workshop, so focus with me here. The 2 is telling me how many, and the 3rd is telling me what kind or what value, all right? So we don't separate them like that, but we could separate these numbers. Remember when we go 1 times 100 plus 3 times 10 plus 2 times 1? And then the 1, 3, and 2 tell us how many, and the hundreds, tens, and units tell us what kind. Remember that? Okay. So in fractions, this top number tells us how many, but the bottom number tells us what kind. You know what's interesting about the decimal system? You can't add two things unless they're the same kind. I'll give you an example. What's 300 plus 200? 500. What's 300 plus 50? 350. Because you can't combine them because you can't add hundreds to tens, right? You can only add hundreds to hundreds and tens to tens and units to units. You see where I'm leading? In the fraction world, I'm trying to help kids to get over this because if you picture yourself, you're 10 years old, you walk into class one day and the teacher says, you can only add two fractions if they have a common denominator. What does that mean? Where did that come from? What's a common denominator? And I've never had restrictions on adding anything before. But if you've taught the decimal system properly, that you can only add hundreds to hundreds and tens to tens, and then when they walk into fraction class, you say, you can only add two fractions if they're the same kind. Very similar to what we've been doing for the last 4 years about adding tens to tens and hundreds to hundreds and lining up our place value. You see how that kind of ties in? So just hold that thought, that the denominator is the what kind. So all we're saying is, could I add 2/5 to 1/5? Why? Because it's the same kind. That's it. And it's the same value. And you don't have to worry about a common denominator, okay? It doesn't mean anything to a kid. Or most adults. So let's go back to this again. Let's do one more just to get our little confidence up here a little bit more. How many pieces do I have up there now? 8. Okay. And let's take this one. Let's take 1/4 of 8. Of, again, represents what symbol? Times. Okay. So if I have 8, what's this line here represent for those that just came in? Divided by, so I take 8 and divide it into 4 equal parts. You're all watching closely to see if I'm going to do it right again. Okay, and how many of those parts do I want?
1.
So I just circle that. So what is our answer? 2. You're just trying to see if I'm awake? With that 6 out there at me. Okay, so the answer is 2, right? And let's make a word problem out of this. Can you think of a word problem where you'd have 1/4 of 8 is 2? This is usually the quietest part of a workshop in America. Very good. So how many donuts did he eat? And how many did his 12 children have? Then we have more fractions. 5. Why, did your wife grab one? Yeah, your wife grabbed one, right? Okay. Do you have 5? Ah, that would work. So then you get 1, and each of them get 1, and Dad gets. This is what we used to do too at our house. You know, like, you never study fractions really until you have like bacon. you know, and you want to have everybody have a piece, you know, so you have, anyway, and you really start dividing them up, don't you? Because we used to have the rule that one person divides and the other person gets to pick first, you know, so the person that's dividing is, ooh, they're really good. All right. Okay, so now we've got that process. There's three steps to fractions: what you start with, what you divide it, divide, denominator, and the number or the numerator. You have that? Okay. Now, I'm going to do something different now. I'm going to shift gears, and I need a little bit of help. I need one volunteer. You don't have to leave your seat. Okay. Isaac, what a great name. My oldest son's Isaac. He's on his honeymoon right now. Just got married Sunday night. Okay, Isaac, this is what I want to do now, take fractions of one. But the people in the back would never be able to see this, and so I need to blow this up. So if you'd be willing to just close your eyes, clap twice, and blow, we'll see if we can make this larger. Very good, very good. It worked. All right. So this is how much, everybody?
One.
Okay, so all we're doing is we're using the same blocks, we're tying them together, but this becomes one, so it's larger. But the green color could be a little confusing, so we're going to use nondescript, okay? So how much is this? If this is one, how much is this?
One.
Okay, very good. So the green one goes night-night. So here's one, and instead of taking two-thirds of six or one-fourth of eight, I'm going to take two-thirds of one. And the way I'm going to divide it is I'm going to divide it by doing this. So I've now taken the one and cut it up into three equal parts, right? And how many parts do I want? Two. So I'm going to slide this little pink guy down in between. Do you see the two-thirds of one? Now I'm going to warn you, if you first hold this up to a child and say two-thirds, they might see one-half. Do you see where they'd see one-half? One and the two. And so you make sure that you do this process, that you first take the one, divide it up into three equal parts, and then bring this guy down in between. So now we have two-thirds. That make sense? Okay. Let me just try another one. And we're just going to practice. It would be much more effective if you had these, and then I could ask you to do one. Because whenever I teach with the hands-on something, I like to build some, and then we write it, and then we say it. Sometimes I say it, and then you build it. And sometimes I write it, and you build it, and I say it. See what I mean? And so it's one thing to watch Michael Jordan play basketball. Another thing to do it yourself, isn't it? Although no one even knows who he is anymore. Okay, let's try Kobe. All right. So now, how much are we starting with?
One.
Dividing it up into?
Four.
Okay. And just write this one down yourself. Don't say it out loud so you can actually get a little practice here. Write down this entire fraction. No. It's a good question. But we are not worried about reducing fractions. We might as well talk about it now, because otherwise, if I wrote 4/8 up on the board, half of you would be having heart attacks until I reduced it, okay? It's a funny thing to do to an audience. I've done it, you know, and they just, people, there's like no closure. Now, it's so. Okay, I'm just going to tell you something. When is the only time you have to reduce fractions in real life? Okay. Do you really discuss those kind of things with people? I mean, I'm sorry to put you on the spot, but okay, not very often, right? Okay. So, but whoever here, I'm not going to tell you. I'm going to let you figure it out. Okay. So, what fraction is this, everybody? 2/4 of one. Now, we're going to quit saying of one, but I want you to keep that in your mind, that fractions are fractions of something. Okay? We made that point. So, this is 2/4, right? Write down this fraction without saying it out loud. There's 8, by the way, on the bottom. You can't see them from back there. How many are yellow?
4/8.
Okay, let's do one more. Those are 16ths. So we're getting close to what you're, if we could do one more, it'd be you and your buddy talking, right? Okay. So what do we have here? 8/16. What does this look like? A ruler. And it turns out the only place that I found that you need to be able to reduce fractions is with measurement in America. I'm serious. If you have metric, look, I've worked on cars. Not a lot, but sometimes I'm under the car and I'm using the 11-millimeter wrench. It's too small. So I say to one of my sons, that's what sons are for, can you go get me the next larger size? What do they have to do? Get the 12, exactly, and maybe the 13. It's not really hard. All right, now, what if I'm under the car, though, and I'm using the half-inch wrench, and it's too small? They don't have two halves wrenches, and so you have to get the next largest one, which would be 9/16. Or if you have money and you actually have 30 seconds, you see what I mean? You have to be able to reduce fractions. Or if the 3/4 is too large, they don't have a 2/4 wrench. So you have to get 8/16. And so the only place I found that you really need to reduce fractions is in measurement. And again, only in countries that don't use metric. Because in metric, you don't have to reduce fractions. Isn't that nice? You all guys want to move? Pretty soon, the gas price will be the same everywhere, so who cares? Anyway, all right. You getting this okay? Okay, now we're going to come to what I think is the watershed concept of fractions. It's called equivalent fractions. And the word is, you can take it apart, equivalent. It means they're the same. So let's go back to our 2/3. So I already have that one made up here. Okay, this is 2/3. And I want to make a fraction that's the same amount, but more pieces. That's the four words I use a lot. Same amount, more pieces. And here it is. So what fraction is that? How many total pieces? Whenever you look at these things, the first question you ask yourself is, how many total pieces? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? How many are pink? 1, 2, 3, 4. And so what we have is 2/3 is the same as 4/6, right? You're not supposed to teach this according to Piaget. You ever heard of Jean-Jacques Piaget? Actually, it's Jean-Jacques Piaget, but that's how you spell it. You know, you got to talk to yourself, Piaget. But it's Piaget, and he taught something called the conservation of matter. And where kids have difficulty, and if I hadn't done the experiment, I wouldn't have believed it myself. I had two balls of clay. And I rolled them up, and I was working with a 6-year-old, and I said, are they the same amount of clay? Yes. They weren't. I massaged them until they were. Then I made a snake while he was watching with one hand. I said, now which one has the most clay? The snake. Put it back in the ball. Now they're the same. Then I made a pancake. That's got more. Then I made a ball. Now they're the same. I'm serious. You try it. 5, 6-year-old, that's what they do. Okay, then I did it with an 8-year-old, and I started. He goes, I don't care what you do to that clay. It's the same amount of clay. Because his brain had moved to a different level of thinking. I did it to a 7-year-old, and there was like smoke coming out of his ear. Because he goes, it should be the same, but that really looks like it's more clay, you know? And you could see he was transitioning in his brain between. It's called the conservation of matter. This is really hard for a child to grasp, that all of a sudden you can double something, and it's the same amount. And they'll say 2/3 equals 4/6. And you stretch your credibility, I think, if you just say, adopt it by faith, Ephesians 6, obey your parents. But 2/3 equals 4/6. Okay, but I've done this with 6-year-olds, and they get it. Because why? They can see it. Okay? Let's keep going. See if we can do another one. How many total parts do we have? 12. How many are pink? 8. Okay. Now let's make it real. Let's say, Katie, that this is you, and this is your mom, and this is a pink chiffon strawberry yogurt all healthy cake, okay? And we ate this piece last night to see if it was any good, but today, you and your mom are just going to eat this all day, okay? No veggies, no salad, no oatmeal. You're just going to have pink chiffons. You like strawberries? Okay, there you go. Now, so you get up in the morning, you're thinking, oh, this is cake day. It's my birthday. This is a good day. And you get out your little plates, and you get out your forks, and all of a sudden the doorbell rings. And who do you think's at the door? Grandma and Grandpa. They came for your party and they don't drive after dark and they missed last night. So you're going to share with them, right? So now you were going to have this piece and now you get this piece. And your mom gets this piece and Grandma and Grandpa get that piece, right? Okay. Is it the same amount of cake? It's just more pieces, right? Okay. And then the doorbell rings again. It's your cousins from out of town. They had a flat, and so they just got here today. And so you're going to share. This is your piece. This is your mom's piece, Grandma, Grandpa, and the four cousins, right? Same amount, but more pieces. Everybody getting this? Okay. I did this once in a school, and this little boy, every time the doorbell rang, he went. And I said, so what are you learning? He goes, don't answer the doorbell until you eat your cake. Okay. So if you can make math real, doesn't that help you to understand it better? Because we all identify. We're all going, come on, eat the cake. Okay. But it's the same amount of cake. And what's interesting, if you're having a birthday party for little kids, if you cut that pizza up into lots more pieces, they think they're getting more pizza. They do. They go home, I had 8 pieces. They don't care how big they are, you know, because they just think more amount. You know this because kids would rather have pennies than a nickel, wouldn't they? And then they get to a certain stage, you go, oh, okay, I'll take the nickel. And then they start asking for the paper, and then their brain is going through different levels of, okay. Now, this next concept is new. This next thing I'm going to teach you, I think, is the most important thing to learn for fractions, but it is tricky. Because, I should say tricky, it's just not familiar because we don't do it in America except with Matthew C. But it is taught in Great Britain. They have a different name for it. And I've met people from Great Britain and that's how they learn fractions. So it is has some stability, if you want to put it that, the good old English stability. I need 2 people to come up here and just stand here and hold fractions. You don't have to say anything. You don't have to do anything. Just smile. All right, so Alice and, oh, good. Corinne, come on up. Alice, thank you. Good. Vanna number 1, Vanna number 2. You have to go like this. Okay. Let's add our 2/3 since we have him out. So Corinne, you can be, Corinne, that's how you say it? Mm-hmm. All right. Corinne the lion. I know what Ariel means in Hebrew. Okay. And now we're going to do, you tell me what fraction this is I'm making. What's my denominator? 4. How many fourths do I have? 1. Come on up closer to the audience, please. There you go. So you can be 1/4. Your only assignment is don't let that yellow one fall to the floor. Why don't you come over here, and we'll just flank the board. All right. You can move the board up a little bit. All right. What is the problem with adding these 2 fractions? Could I add these 2 fractions? They're different kind. And in case anybody has any questions, I'm going to go ahead and add this one to this one anyway. Okay, how does that look? That's right, horrible. It's a mess. They're not the same kind. Shh. You didn't hear that. So what we're going to do is we're going to add 1/4, and we're going to have 1/4 over here, and we got 2/3 over here, and we're going to add these 2 fractions, but our whole motivation, forget the numerator, we're just trying to make the denominators the same kind. And once they're the same kind, then we can anything we want with them. So I'm just going to do this very systematically. I'm going to take the smallest piece I have with the one line, I'm going to put it on top of Alice. What was her denominator? 4. What is it now? 8. Okay. Her denominator is 3. When I put this on, what does it make it? 6. Are they the same kind?
No.
Okay. But we now have 4/6 and 2/8, right? You have to a lot when you do fractions. Okay, so now we take those off, and we say those didn't work. Let's try the next one up. So we'll get the 3rd overlay and put this on. Corinne, what do we have now? What's our denominator?
9.
What was it? Now notice, when this piece goes on, because it's got three parts, it makes what's there three times as large, right? What's her numerator?
Two.
When I put this on, what should it become? Six times three, right? Okay. So it turns out now we have 6/9. Ooh, we're getting closer, 8 and 9, but not there yet. So we take the third overlay and we put it on top of the fourth. What does Alice have now? 12. And how many 12ths does she have?
Three.
Okay. Just hold that one. And so then we take the next one up, which is the fourth overlay. And it's not in the correct pocket. We have a crisis, a momentary crisis. Yeah, but I usually have two of each in the kit. Oh! You ever seen a grown man cry in public? Okay, we're going to just adopt yours for just a second. Okay, what is this one? 12ths. How many 12ths? 8/12. Okay, so this is 8/12. Oh, we already had 12 down here, so can we add them? Okay, are they the same denominator?
Yes.
Once they're the same kind, I can add the two numerators, I can subtract the two numerators, I can compare the two numerators. Compare means less than, greater than, right? Okay. That okay? Yes. Yes. But I didn't have to do any more here because I got it. All right? So now let's do one more with one different fractions. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Oh, stay there. Stay there. We've got one more. I mean, if you don't mind. Okay, this time you can be 2/5. And we'll let you be 1/3. All right? So now we're going to add 2/5 plus 1/3. And we could go through the whole process again, couldn't we, of putting the half on it, the third over it, the fourth over it, the fifth over it. But there's a shortcut. Here's the shortcut. You ready? One step. I like to let the kids figure this out themselves. Because she has a 3 overlay, I'm going to take the other 3 overlay and turn it 90 degrees and put it here. And because Alice has the 5th overlay, I'm going to take that, flip it 90 degrees and put it here. And now what do we have? 15ths, right? Because, just follow this if you can. This is the critical part right here. I know you can, just getting your attention. Verily, verily, that's what Jesus would say. The case of the disappearing fraction, the numberless numerator. All right, what's my numerator?
One.
When I put this on, what will it become? Because this has 5 spaces, right? What's my denominator?
Three.
What's it going to become? 15. So when I put that on, it multiplies them both by a factor of 5, right? And the reason we chose the 5 was because that was her denominator. You got that, right? Okay, I'm going to do this one more time. You're going to think, I got this. But no, you think, sure. What's her denominator?
5.
This piece is going to make it what?
15.
Because it's got
3.
And I chose this, why? It was her denominator, right? And now it makes this 3 times as large. So now it's 6. It makes the denominator 15 because it makes them both 3 times as large, right? Okay. Will that always work? with no exceptions that will always work. Now, the mathematicians in the room are going, no exceptions? I know what your brain's doing. If I can just think of one example. Okay, it works. It won't always give you the lowest common denominator, but I'm not concerned about that because we hardly ever use that in real life. My main concern is making them the same kind. Once you have the same value, then you can do whatever you want with the numerators, okay? So, now let me just record what we just built. We had 1/3, we had 2/5. Okay, I think you could watch now. Thank you very much. I took the fifth overlay and put it on top of these two, and it made them both what? 5 times as large. So I multiply 5 times 1 is 5. 5 times 3 is 15. Sometimes I put little arrows with a multiplication sign just to help you to remember that, right? Then I take the 3 and I put it on top of this one, and it made them both 3 times as large. 3 times 2 was 6. 3 times 5 is 15. Now, what's 5/15 plus 6/15?
11/15.
What's 6/15 minus 5/15? 1/15. Which is larger, 6/15 or 5/15? And I could put the greater than. Once they're the same denominator, I can do anything I want with them. But the key is making them the same kind. Let's do one without the overlays. Let's make a nasty one. 2/7 plus. Yeah, let's make it kind of easy. 4/11, because that'll make it easier to multiply, right? Okay, you want to try it yourself? Try it yourself first, then I'll do it. If you want, if you don't want to do it, still a free country. I mean, we're losing our freedoms, you know, but we're still free so far. Sort of. You want to know about homeschool law, come to Pennsylvania, man. We got like the second worst in the state, in the country, I mean. Okay, so what would be your first step? Multiply 11 times both of these, and I get 22/77. Multiply 7 times both of these, I get 28/77. Now I can add them. What's the answer? 50/77. I could subtract them. 6/77, which is larger, right? Once are the same kind. You got it. Let me give you one more. How many got that one without even watching me? Good job. Okay, here you go. Ready? 5/9 and 3/7. I want you to tell me which one is larger, 5/9 or 3/7. Do that okay? All right. I call this the rule of 4 because I take 4 steps. I multiply this, 1, 2. I multiply this, 1, 2. So that's 4 operations that I do to find the common denominator. All right? Now, in Great Britain, they call it the rule of 3 because you know right from the beginning what your denominator is going to be. So what they do is they just put the 63 down the bottom. It's one step. They multiply these two, 63. Then they go, boom, boom, got it. Okay? The only problem is if you do that too much, which is what I've taught people from the UK, they don't know why it works. They just know that it works. See, they don't understand the concept. And the concept is making them the same kind. So this rule of 4, some of you have been doing for years and you didn't even know it, because if I was to walk in here this morning and say, compare these two fractions, right? You do something called cross multiplication. And what you do is you say 7 times 4 is 28, and you do 9 times 3 is 27, and you say that one's larger. If I had asked you why that worked, what would you have said? I don't know. I'm just happy I remembered the formula, okay? Because most of us don't remember formulas, do we? For example, what's the formula for dividing two fractions? You got to flip something, right? Which one do you flip?
The second one.
Second one. How come?
That's what we learned.
Okay. I mean, I had students in algebra that would come in and flip both of them, then flip the answer back. You know, they knew they had to flip something, and they had to multiply something, but they weren't sure which one to flip and how many times to flip it, and they would give me all kinds of bizarre answers, because that's how we were taught in America. In fact, one way that I heard a guy teaching is, he says, when dividing fractions, don't ask why, flip the sucker and multiply. Okay? Now, I do not endorse that approach. All I'm telling you is that's about how we've been taught in math in America for a long time is don't ask questions, just put the numbers in and figure them out. The problem is if you don't use it all the time, you forget. Because how many of you really knew the formula for fractions would be willing to bet me $20? Yeah, because you knew you had to flip something. And you maybe, okay, I'm going to guess that, Jill, you've taught this recently.
I was a junior high math teacher.
That's how you know this.
Okay.
Well, most teachers I've talked to didn't understand math until about the third year they taught it. Yeah. Okay. So do you see what we did is what we were really doing was we were doing the rule of four, but we didn't know it. So what I'm saying is you've been doing this, you just didn't know. This is the undergirding concept. Make those denominators the same kind. You're probably saying, is there any other topics you're going to talk about? If you walk out of here with this, you've got it. Because I'm going to teach you how to divide fractions a different way. I will teach the flipping thing later. A better way to say it, though, is multiplying by the reciprocal as opposed to invert and multiply. But multiplying by the reciprocal, I will teach in pre-algebra because you need it for algebra and all that. But for it's fourth and fifth grade, you know, 9, 10, 8, whatever, you're studying it, I think this way is better. And here it is. I'm going to let you figure out the formula. We'll make this inductive as much as possible. Okay, what fraction do I have here? Okay, there's first question is how many total pieces? 5. How many are blue? 4. Okay, so if I had 4/5 divided by 1/5, hold, don't say anything, please. If I had just walked in today and said, what's 4/5 divided by 1/5? There'd be people flipping things. You'd be flipping and multiplying and reducing and all kinds of funny things. But we're going to do better than that. We're going to think. And a lot of thinking is how you pose the question. So the question is, how many of these can I count out of this? I want someone under 20 to answer this, please. How many 1/5 are there in 4/5? Yes? 4. Thank you. Isn't that right? There's 4 of these. So the answer is 4. Okay, let's try a little tougher. This time, let's try 2/5. What fraction is this? 4/5. What's 4/5 divided by 2/5? Or how many 2/5 can I count out of 4/5? Everybody? 2. Okay? So we have 4/5 divided by 2/5 is 2. Okay, try this one yourself. What's 3/4 divided by 1/4? Or how would I verbalize this to make it easier? How many 1/4 can I count out of 3/4? And the answer is? Good. Okay, this next one I want you to do silently by yourself, and you're not allowed to flip anything. I want you to just think. No flipping. When you have the answer, just make eye contact. All right? Who thinks they know the answer? All right? Want to try it? 6. Okay. Now, there's several ways how we get this. So all of you that have different ways, it's okay. Let me just put a little tangent in here. There's more than one way to solve most problems. And I've talked to a lot of parents that they say, you know, I used to do some of the stuff you do, but I got in trouble when I was in school because it wasn't the way they said you had to do it. And I got points marked off because I didn't, you know what I mean? And I'm learning from students because students have taught me different ways to solve these things. So give your kids some space. That's all I'm saying. And if they, sometimes the manipulatives will trigger parts of your brain you didn't know were able to trigger. I've learned things by using the blocks. All right, so how did you get six? So you made this 6/8, because you knew times 2 to get that, so you multiplied times 2 to get that. So then you had 6/8 divided by 1/8 was 6. Is that right? Anybody do it a different way? Yes, Alice. You drew it, all right? What'd you do, like this, 3/4? Then what'd you do? Oh, very good, making your own overlays. All right, and then you said how many 1/8s? Okay, anybody do it a different way? See what I mean? We already had two different ways. So what were you doing? No, you do. You did it.
What? I did what you were saying, and I doubled it.
Okay, you made them the same kind.
Yeah.
And then you divided the numerators. Here's my formula. If you make them the same denominator, then you can just divide the numerators, because that's what we've been doing, folks, right? What's 4/5 divided by 2/5? If they're the same denominator, it doesn't make any difference. It's 2. If you really want to be mathematical, you can even say 5 divided by 5 is 1, which is 2, right? But do you ever use this in real life? I'm going to tell you when I did. I have these blocks that are 1¼ inches high, box sets, okay? And I had 16-inch brown, what do they call brown boxes? What color do they call that? There's a name for it. Anyway, I had a brown box, 16 inches, and I had to divide this up to see how many 1¼-inch boxes I could put into it. So how would you do that? I mean, how was you going to use this for shipping? I was trying to figure out how many block sets I could get into this carton that was 16 inches long. So what I did was I said, well, you know, I can just multiply this by 4. And I made this 64/4. So my question was, how many groups of 5 are there in 64? So what did I get? What's 64 divided by 5? Well, it's 12 and 4/5, right? So how many boxes could I get into that container? It's cardboard. It'll stretch. 13. But the thing was, no, but this is a real life problem, you see? Because yes, your answer is you can get a whole number 12 if you're in math class, but if you're in the real world, you don't need packing material because that'll be so tight and snug, you just shove that one in. I mean, you're only talking a fifth, right? So I was able to get 13 of those block sets into one of those containers. But you see, I was able to do that kind of thinking more readily with how many 5s go into that than if I had been flipping things. See, I was able to actually picture, you know, groups of 5 into 64, and I was able to think better. So I'm going to give you one and see if you can do one. Ready? 4/5 divided by 1/7. We're going to jump into one here. Now, before you start, I want you to estimate the answer. See what I mean? It's hard to estimate when you don't have the same denominator, is it? So estimate your answer. 4 apples and 1 orange, I'm not really sure. Okay, do the rule of 4 first. First step, rule of 4. Did you get that? Am I losing some of you? Okay. I multiplied 7 times this and 7 times this, and I got 28 35ths. I multiplied 5 times this and 5 times this, and I get 5 35ths. Now estimate your answer. How many groups of 5 35ths can I get out of 28 35ths? What? Between 5 and 6, right? So right away, if you do this method, you're already in the ballgame because, as you know, in math, estimation is about everything because you need to get close to know if you're even in the ballgame. So now we just take the 28, you divide it by 5, what do you get? 5 and 3/5. This is just normal division problem now. So the answer is 5 and 3/5. That's as hard as they get, folks. I don't know what to tell you. Well, I didn't change the denominator. I'm asking how many groups of 5 are there in 28? Fifths, right, because, right, and if you want to, you can do this kind of stuff, you know, like that. But if you use the overlays at the beginning, you quickly see that the denominator is not important once it becomes the same kind. So if you use the overlays at the beginning, you just see you're dividing numerators once they're the same denominator. It's a good question, though, because that is a potential drawback right here. Yes?
How did you get to fifth?
Because I want to know how many, that's just what she asked, this is good. Once you get the same denominator, it's not important.
Okay.
You just have 28 divided by 5. How many groups of 5 are there in 28?
5.
And 3 of the 5.
Oh.
You okay?
Yeah.
How much time we have? We can teach reducing later. The same way. But the first, okay, how much time do I have? Got 4 minutes? I only have 3 more things on the page. This shouldn't be too tough. Okay, let me do a fraction of a fraction, one of those first. Like if you have 2/3 of 4/5, or 2/3 times 4/5. These are the easiest kind to do, as you know, some of you that taught junior high math, that you just multiply the 2 times the 4 and the 3 times the 5, right? The one thing I want you, the kids, to see, though, is this is the first time they're going to multiply something and end up with something smaller. Because, look, what's 3 times 10?
30.
7 times 9 is 63. Usually when you multiply, your product is much larger, right? Unless you're multiplying by 1 or 0. So now we're going to take 2/3 of 4/5, so our answer is going to be less than what we started with, isn't it? Because we're only taking 2/3 of it. So we're going to start with 4/5. See 4/5? If we had more time, I could let you figure this out, but this is, I'll just tell you. I've got to divide it into 3 equal parts, right? Remember, we started with 2/3 of 6, remember, 1/4 of 8. So we take this and divide it into 3 equal parts. How many of those parts do I want? 2. I've got 3 parts now, but I only want 2 of them, so I have to slide up this bottom one. Okay. Now, you've got 2 rectangles. You've got a white rectangle and a blue rectangle, right? What's the blue rectangle? What are the edges telling us? How far from here to here? 2 times 4. And how many blue ones are we going to have? 8, right? Do you see the 2 times the 4? Okay, how many in the total rectangle? 3 times 5 is 15. And that's where we get the formula. 2 times 4 is 8. 3 times 5 is 15. I'm starting to put some of you to sleep. You're going, man, this is hard. 8 o'clock in the morning, I got a long day. You see that, though? And is this less than what we started with? Yes, because we started with this thing, and now we only want 2/3 of it. How much would this be? 1/3 of it, right? So we've got 1/3, 2/3, 3/3. Does that make sense? Okay. Now I saved a fun part for the end. What fraction is this, everybody? 2/5. I want to change it to a decimal. So I have to make it tenths. How many tenths do I have there? 4/10, right? Now let's write this down. We started with 2/5. We made that 4/10. And now we can write that in the decimal system, which has hundreds place, tens place, units place, tenths place, hundredth place. You see, there's no fifths place, right? Remember, this is the denominator. It's the what kind, it's the what value, it's the place value. And there is no fifths place down here. So if we want to write a fraction as a decimal number, we have to put it in tenths. Bingo, we just did it. Okay. Let's try one more. Come on, Brianne, this is not that tough. 10 in a row, 10 by 10. How many total pieces? 100. How many are blue? Well, if there's 10 in a row, it would be 10, 20, 30, 40, right? So that would be 40 hundredths, which we could write as like that, couldn't we? Or we could do this. Erase that line, take the 1, put it here, take this 0, put it here, take this 0, put it here. Is my back too big? Okay, I'm sorry. How do you do it like reverse? Okay, that's what we had a minute ago, right? Now I'm going to get rid of this line. I'm going to take the 1 here and put it up here. I'm going to take this 0 and put it here, and take this 0 and put it here. You should be breaking into applause at this point because, I mean, this is wonderful. And you don't have to applaud. You're at least getting goosebumps or something. That's what I get because this is one of the hardest things. Remember that class I told you I taught in high school? To change a fraction to a decimal to a percent was like one of the hardest things I could get them. And I would use the words Latin, percent, per hundred, per hundred, you know. But I was just talking here and they were here. But do you see that? 40 hundredths. It's the same amount of cake, isn't it? More pieces. More pieces. A homeschool support group. Okay, so got that? Everybody see that? And you can do most fractions like this, and even ones that don't come out even, you still get a pretty good shot at them if you take like 1/3. You put it under the overlays. Okay, so we had 1/3. What do you think the 1/3 would be? Well, you got 10, 20, 30, and not quite 35, a little bit less than 35. And I've had sixth graders go, maybe 33, 34. Six-year-olds, I mean, would do that because they can see it's less than a half. A half would be like 35. So you see that okay? All right. Any questions? You have negative 1 minute for questions. Yes?
Can you give me an example of how you would, like a real-life situation where you would take a fraction and divide it? Because my son yelled at me this year. Why would you multiply if you were going to get something smaller? Why didn't they divide if they wanted something smaller? I said, well, if you multiply by 1, you get exactly the same. So if you multiply by a fraction, you get something smaller.
Okay. 4/5 of the room is sleepy. And 2/3 of them did not have coffee. How many people didn't have coffee? I mean, that would be an example. Yeah. But, you know, story problems are tough for kids in America because we haven't taught them to think. Once you can think, then the story problems aren't so tough. Let me just give you a bonus for coming early. You ready? Is anybody here teaching mixed numbers? Okay. Well, if you, just real quick. If you have like 3 1/5, minus 1 4/5. That can be a difficult problem, right? Because you have to take the 3 and borrow, make that a 2, and then make that 5/5 and all that. Let me show you a little trick. We call it the same difference theorem. The same difference theorem is, what do I have to add to this number to make it a whole number? 1/5, right? So if I add 1/5 to here, I got to add it to here, then I have 3 2/5 minus 2. So which problem would you rather do? Yeah, because the answer is now 1 2/5. Do you see that? Again, there should be some goosebumps or something here. This is, there you go, a little bit of enthusiasm. Because these are hard problems. But if you can just make the denominator a whole number, then the numerator, and it was just very easy. I mean, the bottom number. I can do this with feet. How tall are you? Okay, let's make it harder. Let's make you 3'11", okay? And I'm 6'5". How much taller am I than you? Well, let's just make this. How much do I have to add to you to make you a whole number of feet? 1 inch. So I add an inch here, and she's now 4 feet. I add an inch here, I'm now 6'6". So now, which one would you rather do? Right? Isn't that cool? Or, what time is it right now? 9:35. What time was it 4 hours and 50 minutes ago? So what do? Make the bottom one a whole number. What do we have to add? 10 minutes. So this becomes 45. This becomes 5. Bingo. I like to mess up with English teachers. This is called the same difference theorem. You know, same difference. Because the difference is the same as long as you make the bottom number a whole number. What's that? Well, no one's late. All right. Thank you very much. You can all get out of here. See you.